Hello everyone and welcome to NewsClick. I'm Apoorva.
I'm Prabir and we'll take a look at the news stories today.
The top story of today is Bilkis Bano. The Supreme Court has ordered Gujarat government to pay 50 lakh rupees as compensation to Bilkis Bano, who was raped, her 3-year-old daughter and her 14 family members killed during the 2002 Gujarat riots. Her story was among the most horrific single incidents of violence during the 2002 riots. On the day of this important order, here is a look back at how the Gujarat government failed the victims.
On March 3, 2002, communal violence had spread across Gujarat after the Godhra incident. Thousands of families were moving to safer places. One of those families was of 19-year-old Bilkis Bano, pregnant at the time. The family was moving in a truck. There were 17 people in it. They suddenly found themselves under attack from a mob of about 30 to 35 rioters. In the next hour or so, all 14 members of Bano's family were killed. Every woman of the family was gang-raped and murdered. Among the deceased was the 3-year-old Saleha, daughter of Bilkis. Saleha's head was smashed with a rock. Bilkis was 5 months pregnant and signs of pregnancies were visible. She was gang-raped, brutalized and left to die. However, she survived and took refuge with a tribal family. She gathered courage to approach the police and lodge a rape complaint. 1 year later, police cited inconsistencies in her statement and the magistrate closed the case, citing lack of evidence. The police threatened her with dire consequences if she proceeded with the matter. Bano then approached the National Human Rights Commission and also petitioned the Supreme Court. The apex court heard the matter and also sought a response from the NHRC. The NHRC backed Bilkis Bano's petition in the Supreme Court, which in December 2003 ordered a CBI inquiry into the case. The CBI found the evidence which Gujarat police claimed they had been unable to find and also exhumed the bodies of those killed for examination. In 2004, all the accused named by Bilkis Bano were arrested and tried in Sessions Court and the sentence of life imprisonment of 11 confirmed by the Bombay High Court. The Bombay High Court also convicted 5 policemen and 2 doctors for not performing their duties and tampering with the evidence.
Two individuals, Ashok Mochi and Kutubuddin Ansari, became the iconic images of the Gujarat violence. Both of them today are campaigning in North Kerala for the CPIM candidate P. Jayaraj.
All parliamentary constituencies in the state went to post today in phase 3 of India's general elections. The presidents of 2 of India's biggest parties, the BJP and Congress, are among the key candidates in the third phase, which took place today. While the other states in this phase had good voter turnout, Jammu and Kashmir registered a very low turnout of just over 11% by 5 p.m. Joining us to discuss this and all the other election stories worth tracking is NewsClick Chief Editor Prabir Purkayastha. So, Prabir, if you could just take us through the violence that has happened in different states.
Let's look at first the violence in Bengal, because there are reports now that Murshidabad, North and South Malda, Jangipur have all seen violence. 5 of the constituencies are going to polls today in this phase. In Murshidabad, the sitting MP of the CPIM, Badruddin Khan, was also intimidated, surrounded by TMC goons and threatened. So we seem to see what already the Special Officer Nayak had talked about, that this time we are seeing unprecedented violence. Though, of course, we know that this level of violence has been there in previous elections in Bengal as well, particularly under the TMC regime. So I think this is something that the Election Commission has to take note of. And what they will do, we have yet to see. In Tripura, already Tripura East, the vote was postponed there. It was originally scheduled for 18th, is now taking place today. We had also seen in Tripura West large-scale violence, and in fact the Election Commission itself has agreed there has been intimidation and booth capturing and so on. So we'll have to see what again the Election Commission does in Tripura, what they do about Tripura west when finally they have to take stock and give a judgment about whether it should go for repoll or how many booths will go in for repoll. This is a story that is still to be seen because the Election Commission has yet to take a final call on this one. We've also seen violence in Moradabad where a poll official has been killed. It appears by BJP cadres, goons, whatever we want to call them. And that's again something that we have to monitor and see what's happening. Overall, Gujarat today and Kerala had full state going to elections and the voter turnouts in both the states, as you have said, have been good. So we'll have to see what the results are. We have discussed earlier also that Kerala is a difficult state to call because quite often the assembly and the parliament voting is not similar, and also because the margins are so low in Kerala because whichever party wins by narrow margin. And Sabarimala, what's been the effect of Sabarimala on the elections, we have to see.
Alright, so moving along, the electoral scenario in Delhi has become clearer after all three major political parties declared their candidates for the seven seats. One interesting development is the announcement of the so-called celebrity candidates by both the Congress and BJP in the national capital. Singer Hans Raj Hans will contest from Northwest Delhi for the BJP. Olympic Games medalist Vijender Singh represents the Congress in South Delhi, while ex-India cricketer Gautam Gambhir will take on AAP's Atishi and Arvind Singh Lovely of the Congress. NewsClick sports journalists Leslie Xavier and Siddharth Ani chat about the appearances of these athletes in the mix.
Does this appear to be a selection of celebrity or so-called celebrity big-name candidates over people who have a proven track record or some substance in terms of governance?
There will be dissent in the party ranks, I'm sure, because these guys are fresh in the game. Pun intended, that way. But yeah, Gambhir's case was expected in a way because the way he has been towing BJP's line in the last few years, tweeting, getting into controversies, playing the nationalism game, things like that. And then he retired last December, and last month he joined the BJP, and this was expected. Vijender is a surprise, and but maybe not to the boxer himself, because he has always been a smart player, and the way he has shifted careers through the years from the amateur ranks where he was not going anywhere, he shifted to professional boxing, and in professional boxing he's not going anywhere.
So I wanted to ask you on this. He won a bronze medal at Beijing in 2008, becoming one of the very few Indians to have achieved that fantastic feat. But at the same time, like you said, a fairly rigged or sort of planned foray into professional boxing, which didn't go anywhere because of age and various other reasons. Followed, also there was a drug scandal in which he was sort of embroiled, where heroin was found in his car, or a car that was registered in his name or his family's name. But he got out of that. DSP in the police, who has now resigned his role and moved into politics. Is this a wise choice for the Congress party from a place that's so much sort of South Delhi in the capital? Is this a wise choice?
Congress has made a mistake, no doubt about it, because Vijender, being an Olympic medalist and all that, he has done great in boxing, but when you look at what he has done post that, there have been a lot of controversies, the drug controversy which happened in 2012, and there was a lot of pulling of strings and all that. By the way, that time it was the Congress government. And so, and it was right before the London Olympics, so they saved him.
In international news, a left-wing activist has been assassinated in Philippines. For more on that story, we have Prasanth.
Thank you, Apurva. The activist, Toto Patigas, was assassinated on April 22nd. He's an activist of the Bayan Mula Party and a councillor for the city of Escalante. He was riding his scooter when unknown assailants hit him on the back of his head. This is the third attack on an activist of the Bayan Mula Party since January, when activist and negotiator Randy Malayo was assassinated. Incidentally, Patigas was actually a survivor of the infamous Escalante massacre in 1985, in which over 35 people were killed. This attack comes in the aftermath of the massacre of nearly 14 peasants in the province of Negros Occidental in March, where this attack also happened. Philippines is seeing its interim general elections next month. and the government of Rodrigo Duterte has already initiated a massive crackdown on dissidents. Many of these dissidents are accused of being associated with the Communist Party of Philippines, which is banned. This practice, known as red tagging, is then used to arrest and persecute many of these activists. Duterte's government is also infamous for its so-called war on drugs, in which hundreds of innocent people have been killed. Last month, the Philippines withdrew from the International Criminal Court after the latter insisted that investigation into these murders would continue. Our second story for the day is from Ukraine, where a comedian has actually become a president. Vladimir Zelensky won a massive 72% of the vote and decisively defeated the incumbent Petro Poroshenko. Poroshenko, who came to power in 2014, has been extremely unpopular due to the civil war in the country, as well as his closeness to the US, the EU, and NATO. During his time, provinces dominated by Russian speakers started a rebellion, and there was even a referendum in the province of Crimea in which people finally decided to even join Russia. It's unclear how much space Zelensky will have to implement his agenda. He has indicated that he wants to maintain the territorial continuity of Ukraine and is open to negotiations with Russia. At the same time, the US, NATO, and the EU are unlikely to give him much space. Ukraine has become one of the major fault lines in the world, as the Western powers are trying their best to increase the span of influence, which is being resisted by Russia. That's all we have time for today. Keep following some of these stories on our website, newsclick.in, and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you.